So that's the title of my talk, Repealing Competition Law, probably a good idea. The first thing that I want to insist on is that what's happening in the realm of competition law in that 21st century is really not new. And in fact, the same thing happened again and again, you know, during the past centuries. So reading, the journal articles, reports from the Commission, the EU Commission, we get the idea we live in a very dangerous world. And there is all this fancy word that you can find nowadays, such as practices by especially in the digital market, that's supposed to be things we should worry about. So you have things such as versioning, dark patterns, killer acquisitions, squashing, tipping, you know, all kinds of things that apparently require the regulator and competition authority to step in and try to protect us from those dangerous practices. Now, interestingly, the same thing happened, you know, way back in history. For instance, in England, you had the statutes against regrating, badgering, engrossing, forestalling. And same thing, at that time, those practices were seen as detrimental, as hurting the market process and hurting consumer welfare. What happened to this those previous version of competition law from the 17th century? You know, this is, I think, something which is worth spending a few minutes. I'll be quick, but I think it's interesting. First, as you know, most probably, what used to be called a monopoly in the 17th century was basically a privilege granted to the state. Now, I often have to mention that to students who once pointed out to me that Adam Smith was against monopoly, and which is true. But of course, at that time, monopoly, and you got the definition of Cook, is an institution or allowance by the king to any person, okay, for the sole buying, selling, making, working, or using anything, whereby any person are thought to be restrained of any freedom or liberty. So by definition at that time, if there was a monopoly, it means that the freedom of market participants was de facto and de jure reduced, okay? Those monopolies, those privileges are things that, of course, we should worry about. And actually, people have been worrying about it. And as you know, the Statute of Monopoly in 1624 voided all those privileges. Now, of course, it didn't last for long because government is too tempting for government to distribute privileges, and they came back. Now, at the same time you had monopoly, you had, as I mentioned earlier, some market practices that were considered as criminal offenses, right? I gave you the names of those things earlier on: regrading, badgering, engrossing, forestalling. Now, if you read Smith's Wealth of Nations, interestingly, Smith, who of course opposed monopoly in the sense that monopoly had, you know, in the meaning that the word monopoly had at that time, but he also opposed all those market regulations that were considering as criminal those practices. Here is a quote from Smith. He says, "The popular fear," and this sounds, I think, so modern, because we could say the same thing nowadays about squashing or tipping or things that people say about Google, Facebook, and the GAFA and so on. So here is Smith: "The popular fear of engrossing and forestalling may be compared to the popular terrors and suspicions of witchcraft. The unfortunate wretches accused of this latter crime were not more innocent of the misfortune imputed to them than those who have been accused of the former. And the law which put an end to all prosecutions against witchcraft, which put it out of any man's power to gratify his own malice by accusing his neighbor of that imaginary crime, that law seems effectually to have put an end to those fears and suspicions by taking away the great cause which encouraged and supported them. Okay, the law which should restore entire freedom to the inland trade of corn would probably prove as effectual to put an end to the popular fears of engrossing and forestalling. In a way, I think it's fair to say that if Adam Smith was alive, he will be probably very upset about everything coming from our competition authority nowadays. Now, what happened later on is that that's one way to put it, competition was repealed. Here is a quote that one of my students found in Wilberforce, and it's in the whereas of a decision dating 1889. And of course, this is interesting because 1889, as you know, is just 1 year before 1890, which is the Sherman Act. Okay, so a new wave of competition law, of antitrust law, is coming, the following year. But here is a quote, which again, is a very interesting. It says, the ancient common law of the country and the statutes with reference to the acts known as badgering, forestalling, regrading, and engrossing indicated the mind of the legislature and of the judges that certain large operations in goods which interfered with the ordinary course of trade were injurious to the public. They are criminal accordingly, but early in the reign of George III, the mind of the legislature showed symptoms of change in this matter, and the penal statutes were repealed, and the common law was left to its unaided operation. Now, this repealing statutes contains in the preamble the statement that it has been found by experience that the restraint laid by several statutes upon the dealing with corn, meal, flour, cattle, and sundry, other sorts of victuals, by preventing a free trade in the said commodity, had a tendency to discourage the growth and to enhance the price of the same. This statement is very noteworthy. It contains a confession of failure in the past, the indication of a new policy for the future. So I'll come back on that quote at the end. Again, for me, what is interesting, because sometimes we feel desperate to see things moving, is that there were something very similar to our competition law, market regulation. I personally don't see the difference between the two, even though some people insist that there is one, but I'll come back to that. And so there has been already a repeal, and this repeal was based on the observation that it was not working. Now, let me move on. Okay, so why should we repeal competition law again? Because this has been done already in history. You can either tackle the question from a theoretical point of view or from the kind of philosophy of law point of view, or you can make maybe an empirical argument in favor of the repeal of competition law. So I will be going quickly through those three dimensions. Now, the theoretical argument, I think we can go quickly. I'm sure all of you know this pretty well. And I put this one of the, that's a book I gave to my student actually to read for my class. They have to read Kirstner and the How Markets Work in the Institute of Economic Affairs format. So the theoretical argument comes from the fact that the market is, as you know, this spontaneous order of action that emerged as soon as property rules are defined and enforced. So I think this is by far the best definition of the market. It's basically what you get once you define properly property. And therefore it's the discovery process. Why? Because property triggers that discovery process. Let me mentioned someone who surely does not have exactly the same view as me on competition, no, but Judge Posner, if you read Richard Posner's book, Economic Analysis of Law, and in the chapter on property, he started with this remark. He says, economists distinguish between static and dynamic analysis. Static analysis, says Posner, suppresses the time dimension of economic activity. All adjustments to change are assumed to occur instantaneously. The assumption is unrealistic, but often fruitful. Now, honestly, I'm not sure that it is often fruitful, but that's Posner's point of view. Now, interestingly, dynamic analysis continues is usually considered more complex and advanced than static analysis. And it says it is therefore interesting that the economic basis of property rights was first perceived in dynamic terms. Okay, so the reason why it's interesting to have property rights, that you can understand only if you see things in dynamics, okay, if you have that time dimension. And because the market is, by essence, what you get once you have property rights, it has to be tackled in a dynamic way. Now, very quickly, why property rights trigger dynamics comes from the very nature of almost all property rights regime. You know, just here I use the old Roman law approach to property rights. It gives you the usus, the fructus, and the abusus. Now, usus and fructus means that you have an exclusivity on the choice of the use of the thing, and the fruits also are exclusive, they are for you. And this, of course, gives you incentive to think about what could I do with what I own, knowing that the fruits will be for me. So that's where the discovery process is triggered, okay? Now, abusus is also important. It's the owner has the right to transfer the above rights. And therefore, this is interesting because it means first that he will continue investing in the thing, because if you invest in what you own, it gives more value to the thing. Beyond the transfer, the potential transfer. And of course, it also gives incentive for others to reflect on what they could do with what you own, okay? The entrepreneur, for instance, will have incentive to, gather property with which he believes he can produce wealth and profit, okay? So the dynamics of the market is essentially the dynamics related to property. Now, what does that mean for competition law? Well, the dynamics of the market is by definition unpredictable, okay? Even for the best experts, you know, even if you have been working for the competition authority for decades, you cannot unveil the dynamics of the market. The only thing you can do is explain that it is indeed dynamics. As a conclusion, you know, as a consequence also, there is no such a thing as a market for this or for that, okay? Except maybe in the mind of the businessmen or of the market participants who believe that there is a market for their goods, for their services. And sometimes their beliefs turns out to be wrong, you know, that there is not, you know, the demand that they expected. Now, I can elaborate on that. I wrote a paper some decades ago where I explained that, therefore, what is known as a rule of reason in competition law. The rule of reason, which is that idea that, you know, we should not have a per se rule that, that will prohibit such and such behavior, that on the contrary, we should deal with each case, you know, and study for each case what are the costs and benefits associated to that behavior. Now, that rule of reason, which indeed looks a priori very reasonable, okay, because you say, okay, there is no, you know, no prohibition, we should see things case by case on the nature of the case. Well, it's not reasonable. It's not reasonable because it's assumed that you know a lot of things, that you can predict the consequences of this and that practices, which you can't, okay? So for that reason, we should not rely on that. So to link it to some things known to all of us, you know, this is an instance of what Hayek named the pretense of knowledge. Now, I told Syed I will mention Bastiat at some point. I mean, what is really interesting is that, you know, those things have been known forever. You know, the true question is, why do we forget about them? I'm sure you, all of you know that wonderful essay of Bastiat, The Seen and the Unseen. But, you know, if you want something for England, you know, you can use Marshall as well. Marshall, which I think was pretty sophisticated, much more than his followers, you know, wrote those, that thing, for instance. He says, those effects of an economic cause which are not easily traced are frequently more important than in the opposite direction to those which lie on the surface and attract the eyes of the casual observer. It really sounds like Bastiat, you know. What is unseen usually goes in the opposite direction from what is seen. And of course, the legislator on the market authorities, they will focus on what is seen, you know, on what is what comes easily out of their static understanding of things. This is one of the fundamental difficulties, says Marshall, which have underlying and trouble the economic analysis of past times, and I think of present times as well. Its full significance is perhaps not yet generally recognized, and much more work may need to be done before it is fully mastered. And I think with, you know, what he wrote is still very valuable today, maybe unfortunately, but to a large extent. Now, quickly, the philosophical, I mean, I put that in quote because it's more philosophy of law, the philosophical arguments. Basically, the idea here that we should give a chance again to the rule of law by moving back from legislation to law. Okay, so that's the idea. So we all agree, and when I say that competition law should be repealed, it doesn't mean that the market does not needs a rule. It does need rule. Actually, the market is defined by rules. Okay, you get a market when you have rules that are well defined and enforced. Okay, so the question is more on the type of rules. Okay, and this is the rules of the market. So the competition law, you know, what competition law should be, is basically property law, contract law, tort law. I mean, all this set that are at the basis of common law, civil law in continental France. Here is a quote from a paper by Vandel. I don't know if you saw that paper, 2015, on an Austrian approach to antitrust. So he says, and following Hayek, the rule of the market should be abstract, and we find here all the usual things about rule of law. It should be abstract in the sense that they merely describe those actions which are not allowed, and leave it to the individual to discover innovative modes of action. So negative rights, so to speak. Okay? You should not lie, you should not cheat, you should not, you know, do all those bad things. They must be general. applicable to unknown and indefinite number of persons and cases. Okay. As we will see in a minute, almost opposite to what we see right now. They must be certain, okay, valid for a long time. And here again, very different from what we got now with competition law and antitrust law, so that the economic agents can build stable expectations. Okay. And you can also add a little bit of Kirchner and Frédéric Sauté. Government policy must refrain from any regulations that negatively affect financial gains as a crucial motivation of the entrepreneur. So this is a fructus. I mean, if you change the fructus, all the market dynamics is armed. All right. Well, unfortunately, we are not moving in that direction. I will not introduce you to that lady. You all know her. We are moving quite the contrary to sectorial regulation. And not only in the EU, by the way, the UK is very good at that. You are extremely, you are interestingly, as I was reading those last days, the EU now, the Commission often refer to the UK, say we will just replicate what is done in the UK, with a market investigation and all those things. Apparently, you had the paper in July 2020 that suggests that there should be a special regulation for Google and Facebook. This is coming from New Market Authority, but it's really going totally opposite to the rule of law story. And actually, the Court of Justice and in France also the Constitutional Council even start to worry about that. I mean, maybe we'll have time in discussion for that, but apparently, fortunately enough, the courts are a little bit more reasonable than the competition authority. So now, for instance, the idea of structural remedies, okay, is becoming very powerful. And with this idea, and this is a new package on digital services, that sometimes even before any infringement to competition law occurs, there should be an ex ante regulation as soon as there is some concern from those experts about the fact that consumers eventually could be hurt. Okay, so we really, and this of course is very hard to predict, so we are really going opposite to what Hayek was suggesting. Now, very quickly, because I see my time is almost over, I want to say a few things about the empirical argument. Unfortunately, I don't have much to say here, but that's one of my points. Maybe we should be working more on that. So the idea is, you perform better when you have competition law? I mean, there are two papers that I often quote, and I'll be happy if you have more study to point out to me. One is a paper by Stephen Voigt, who is now at the Hamburg Law and Economics Center, Institute for Law and Economics, and this paper they from 2006, I think was published in 2009. And let me read it. It says, the next slice of the conventional wisdom, so this is the kind of thing you are taught if you go to a class on competition law, the conventional wisdom reads somewhat like this. The beneficial functioning of competition is not secured spontaneously, but must be supported by state action, such as competition laws and competition agencies. Given this conventional wisdom, writes Stephen, it is surprising how little we really know about the effects of competition policies. Are competition agencies conducive to higher rates of economic growth? Does it make any difference whether they are independent from government? Does this all independently of the contents of competition laws, okay? Stephen Voigt, see his work, his research as pioneering in that direction. And the conclusion of the paper, actually, of that paper, is that, competition law doesn't have much effects. And in fact, it's close to, you know, no clear evidence in the sense that if you add to his empirical study any variable related to quality of institutions, it's basically a trump whatever you can get from competition law. So what is important is to have sound institutions, that for sure. But does competition law add something to this? The conclusion of that paper was, you know, not really. A more recent study was published by Bob Lawson and Ralph Murphy in 2016. And here is their conclusion. Using new measures of the scope and strength of antitrust policy, we find only the weakest evidence that more robust antitrust regimes correlate with more intense local competition. This relationship disappears upon the introduction of simple controls. Okay. So as soon again as you add up other variables, the impact of competition of antitrust policy is negligible. So what do we do now? Well, I need to stop talking quickly. Well, maybe one of the things we should do is maybe to push, if we want to shed doubt on actual antitrust policy and competition law, we should probably work on the empirical dimension. Now, I'm not myself a big fan of empirical studies. I'm aware that there are counterfactuals here. I'm aware of the limit of what we can do with just pointing out to facts. But still, that might turn out to be powerful in terms of changing the mentality. Remember, and here I use again that quote from the beginning, that quote from 1889, it has been found by experience that the restraints laid by several statutes upon the dealing with corn, meal, flour, cattle, and sunrise, by preventing a free trade in the said commodities, had a tendency to discourage the growth and to enhance the price of the same. Now, I don't know to what extent, you know, that judge reading of history is perfect, but I think it could make sense. If at some point they repeal competition law in the late 18th century, it is probably because they were convinced at some point that the results are not that great and even maybe negative. Well, for instance, Schneider, who just published an interesting paper for the Competitive Enterprise Institute, Enrique Schneider from Switzerland, has been often arguing that there might be some reason why all the GAFA comes from the US, and this might be due maybe to a competition law. I think we need more of this type of reflection. We need also to build a new generation of scholars economists, judges, and representatives. I know that this is the kind of thing that is done at IEA, that we try to do at IES Europe, and you know, try to again shed some doubts on all this intellectual machinery that is so supportive of the present antitrust policies. And I think with this, I mean, I've got a few references here that you could find later on. Let me put it, so Schneider, it's paper Competitive Enterprise Institute, Lawson and Murphy, it's in the Applied Economic Letters, Stephen Boyd is on SSRN, Jürgen Wendel, Competition and Antitrust Policy, an Austrian Economic Perspective, this is in a book from 2015, Progress in Economic Research, and I wrote a piece where I present similar ideas in 2008. And with this, I stop here. And I guess, Syed, you will organize a debate.